Hello and welcome. You are looking at a huge overview of transformations, all of the geometrical different things that you can do with shapes. Anyway, this is going to have a bunch of example problems involving translations, reflections, rotations, symmetry, and dilations, and they'll actually be in that order. Now, these are coming from a textbook, all these example problems, and they came with specific numbers. I'm actually using them for a class. So if you're on the outside looking in, just note that it will start on problem number 8. There is no glitch there. 1 through 7 is being skipped. And it ends on problem number 28, in case you're curious. Okay, so up here will be visible in every slide some words defining transformation. This will always appear in every slide in isometry, pre-image and image. And then this part here, the next part, it'll have what I'm specifically referring to for the example problems. This is translation, and it covers some parts of translation. You can go ahead and read it, and hopefully I'll cover the rest of those parts for you. So we have two example problems where we're going to find the image of each triangle for the given translation. So first is triangle ABC with these vertices. I'll go and plot them now. 5, 9 is A. B is 6, 3. Kind of already know what you're going to end up doing with this, so you might as well start plotting them. And C is at 1, 2. Let me go ahead and connect those. And anyway, we're going to do a translation that is 2 units. I want you to understand this syntax here. This is for any x, y points that we have here, doesn't matter if it's the vertices or the points that are in between, every single set of points we are going to shift the x values 2 units to the right and the y values 3 units up, every single one. Now we are specifically going to look at points A, B, and C and shift those ones. And when we connect the points in between, all the other points will have shifted as well. And the result of the two will kind of give this look of a 3D image. I'll show you what I mean there. Starting with A, and this is kind of unfortunate because I'm going to go off the graph, 1, 2, and let's say it goes 1, about 2, 3 up. I don't know if that's perfect. That one's not the best one to make use of, but this is A prime. Let's say it's about up there. B, if I go 2 units, again, you're adding 2 to your values and 3 units up. Here's B prime. And C, 2 units to the right, 3 units up, and right there. Now, when I connect these points, these specific ones here, I will get another triangle. It should be called an isometry, where it is the same triangle as the one we just saw prior to it. So you can see, I don't look like I made it perfect, perfect. But let's say we connected these. I'm going to use black. What if I connected C with C prime, B with B prime, and A with A prime? This one's not the perfect example, but you kind of see that 3D image that we made. It's like a triangle that's shooting out of the page. Imagine that the red is in front, and it's coming out toward you. If you did this right, your thing should look like a 3D image. If you accidentally rotated some objects, then something's going to be wrong. That's not to say I did anything right or wrong. In fact, I haven't even found the vertices. If you wanted to get a second way of doing this problem, what you could have done was use these vertices. I could have added 2 to the x values and added 3, shouldn't write 3 as I'm doing it, and I could have added 3 to the y values, and I could have just confirmed that those are at those proper points. A prime is at 7, 12. As it so appears, I believe that's up near 7, 12 there. B prime is at 8, 6, and C prime is at 3, 5. And you can take a look at those. If I screwed up, well, we can correct me later, but I think that that's about as it's supposed to be. So I'll keep those up there. I don't think it'll run into this next one. If it does, oh well. Number 9, we have triangle RST with vertices R at 0, negative 4, S at negative 2, negative 1, and T at negative 6, 1. I'm going to go ahead and move that S letter up a little bit, just so I can connect these. This is a pretty obtuse triangle. It's all very close together. So let me first connect these. RST. There we are. Now we're going to do a transformation where we shift everything 4 units to the left and 7 units up. Now this time, instead of doing the counting, let's go ahead and do it that second way I was talking about, just for variation. So every x value, I'm going to subtract 4. 0 minus 4, negative 2 minus 4, negative 6 minus 4. And every y value, I'm going to add 7. And after that, I'm going to find the points, then I'm going to go ahead and plot them in. I think everything will be exactly as we'd like it to be. So our prime will be at the point negative 4, 3. S prime, subtract, is negative 6, comma, positive 6. And then T prime, negative 6 minus 4 is negative 10. 1 plus 7 is 8. So if we plot those three points there, let's see where we end up. I'll use purple. Not that it coincides with these, but let me just underline that. Purple. R is at negative 4, 3, or R prime. S prime is at negative 6, 6. I think that's it. And T prime is at negative 10, 8. And once again, the triangle will be facing exactly as it was before, meaning R prime will be the lowest one, and this will still be skinny as it was. It's an isometry of the pre-image, but now it's in a completely different location. And again, if I connected these points in such a way so that S and S prime were together, R and R prime were together, good as I can make it, T and T prime were together, you can maybe see a 3D image. You know, these aren't the best examples to be talking about 3D images with, but that's a terrible example. I like that one more. So 3D image, there it is. We graphed these together, and we're good to go. Okay, now we have another example here. And this one, I'm not really going to be using the graph that much. I can see where there might be some questions going like, where does this thing end up? Find a single translation that has the same effect as each composition. So what happens here is you have a composition of translations. It just means one translation built on another. And by that, it means that after I do this translation, this translation will be based off of this translation. So what does that mean? After I translate some XY points, I'm not going to go back to the original pre-image and do this next translation. I'm going to do it based on this one here. So the best way of showing you this on the graph to make use of it is I'm just going to go ahead and plot some XY point. I'll just do it at the origin. Maybe that'll be the best way of making use of this. Now, we don't know where XY is. Okay, that's not the point of this. The point is, what is the rule that would make both of these end up in that final spot? Meaning, after the first translation, I'm going to take 0 and subtract 5, go 5 to the left. Then I'm going to go 7 up, 4, 5, 6, 7. Now I'm at this place here. If this point was A, then this point is A prime. And that point, I don't really care where the point is right now, but I care that it is where it is. And what I'm going to do with this is I'm going to add 3. I'm going to go 3 to the right. Then I'm going to go 6 down. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. That's A double prime. The question that it's asking is, what did you have to do? What's the rule, translation rule, to go from A to A double prime? And that's all it's asking. So on a graph, I would say, well, I go 2 to the left, and I go 1 up. So as a rule, that would be going from some point to 2 to the left, 1 up, like so. And that's all you do. And I'll show you the different way of doing it here, just without a graph, just with the math. You'll make sense of it there. Now the real question is, did it matter what point I was originally at? Did it matter if I was at the origin or if I was at the point 9, 4? No, you'd still go 2 to the left and 1 up after all the transformations that you did. Okay, so keep that in mind. It doesn't matter where you start, where you finish will be 2 to the left, 2 less in your x value, and 1 more in your y value than before. That's for number 10. Number 11, let's do it without the graph completely and just think about kind of what we did to make this happen. It's not too much. Let's do the x's only, then we'll do the y's. So from an x value, you go 10 to the right. Okay, from this point, we're going to go 1 more to the right. So the question is, how much more are we going from the original point? Well, let me do that again. Well, for the x values, we added 10, then we added 1. Simple as that. You're not really doing more than that. You're just taking those and, you know, making that happen. The y values, you start by going down 7, subtract 7 from y. Then from that point, we're going to add 5 to it. So we went down 7, then we went back up 5. So how do you do that? Just put those all together. So x plus 10 plus 1 is x plus 11. And y minus 7 plus 5 is y minus 2. So wherever you started from, whatever x, y value this was, add 11 to x, subtract 2 from y. Or go to the right 11 units, then go down 2 units. And then you'll be where you want to be. And again, this is a general rule. Same effect as the composition. That's all it means. Okay, now we're switching on to reflections. A reflection is an isometry in which a figure and its image have opposite orientation, meaning however something was faced before, it has now had a mirror image of what it had before. So we're going to do, there are only three problems with reflection, so I'll see how much I can talk about with these three without not giving away enough. Right? I want to make sure I expose everything about reflections that I can. So given points A, B, and C, I'm going to go and graph those. 6, 4, negative 2, 1, and 5, 0. And to make a triangle out of them, let's reflect it across the x-axis, the line x equals 4, and then the line y equals x, which will obviously be the kind of challenging one here. So connect and connect. Okay, let's reflect it across three lines. Let's do one at a time. Let's make sure this doesn't look too confusing, because if I do a few too many, you're going to have issues seeing what you're looking at. So the x-axis is this guy right here. Now, even I sometimes have this, you know how, like, you don't memorize, you don't want to memorize things, so to speak, but every so often, when you're used to doing something so many times, you accidentally confuse yourself. You don't know how many times I've written the x-axis, or I've drawn a line for the x-axis for this right here. Because after doing so many reflections and using x equals this, x equals that, and they're vertical lines, you hear x-axis, you go at x equals 0, and you screw yourself up. I'm going to try and make sure I don't do that. I already did x-axis there. I'm so far so good. Now the line for the x-axis, just so you're aware, is y equals 0. So they're both the same thing. So we're going to reflect these three points across the x-axis, and all that means is that we're going to find the distance of every point away from the x-axis, and distance is measured as a perpendicular distance. So for instance, A, if I'm going to find the distance to the x-axis, I want to find the shortest one. That one will be perpendicular. If x-axis is horizontal, then this count will be vertical right here. I'm going to count downward, and it's 4 units away from the x-axis. When it reflects across the x-axis, I'm going to go 4 units down here to find out where A prime is going to rest, and it's at that point right there. Now that point is called, oh, what's that called? 6, negative 4. Okay. B prime, it's only 1 unit away, and again, I'm counting vertically, it's 1 unit away there, so on the other side, B prime will also be 1 unit away. And B prime sits at negative 2, negative 1. Finally, C prime, it's on the x-axis, so when it flips over, it's 0 units away from it, so when you flip it over, it's also 0 units away from it. C and C prime are on the exact same place. They're both right there. So C prime is also at 5, 0 as we reflect that. And if you connect the points, I'd like for you to observe in whatever way you'd like. Normally, if you look at the line of reflection, whoops, let's make that solid. If you look at the axis of symmetry, that green line, x equals 0, see, I just said x equals 0, the x-axis up and down, then you'll see the mirror image probably better than any other way. For instance, I'm turning my head 90 degrees so I can take a look at blue on the left and red on the right, and I see that they're a mirror image of each other. You've kind of confirmed it with yourself by looking down the axis of symmetry, if that makes sense. So I'm going to go ahead and remove that stuff again, because I want to do this again with another set of lines. So that was for part A. Let's go ahead and do part B, or sorry, number 12. Let's do it for number 13. Okay, for x equals 4. Okay, x equals 4 is a vertical line. 1, 2, 3, 4. Going right down here, right down 4. And we're going to reflect the points across. Now this one's different for two reasons. One, because now your line's vertical instead of horizontal, so we're going to be counting left and right instead of up and down. And two, because some of the points are on the other side of the line. So if you considered B to be in the regular world and the other side to be in mirror world, well, A and C are already in mirror world. So you have to treat each individual point as their own respective, within their own respective worlds. B is in its real world, and on the other side is B's mirror world. Hope this language is making sense. And A is in its own real world, and on its other side is its mirror world. So let's go ahead and look at A first here. It's 2 units away perpendicularly to the to x equals 4 to the line of symmetry. So 2 units away on this side will be A prime, and it's going to sit right there at the point, what is that? 2, 4. Okay. B prime, I think this is going to fall off the graph, but 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 units away. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 units away right there. So where B prime is, I think that's 10 away in the x direction and 1 away in the y direction. And C prime, 1 away, 1 away. So notice how they all flipped their own respective worlds, and now they're on those other ends. And when I plot the points, yeah, they're going to cross through in such a way that they actually cross through each other. Kind of interesting, but because this one's looking up and down, I think you can kind of notice that symmetry. Kind of looks like a bat in a way, actually. But anyway, so there's symmetry where they're across each other in those mirror worlds, and that's where they rest. C prime, what did I say it was? That's at 3, 0. Okay, I'm going to go ahead and copy this, delete the rest, and I'll paste this back in. Sorry, 1 second. Okay, there we are. Let's go ahead and do number 14 now. This is going to be the most difficult one. We're going to go across y equals x. Okay, and y equals x, if you don't know how to graph that, well, I'd say use a table, but I'd also say think about it. Whatever x is, y is. They're both the same thing. If you still have trouble with it, let's go ahead and call that y equals 1 over 1 x plus 0. I know we all like y equals mx plus b form, and if you want to think about it that way, well, you start at 0 for your y-intercept, then you go up 1 over 1, up 1 over 1, up 1 over 1, back and forth. So how am I going to graph that? Go ahead and take my green. And I know this is at negative 10, negative 10, which makes sense. X and Y are both the same thing. I'm going all the way up to at least through 10, 10. And here's the line of Y equals X. Okay, now we have to reflect across this line. Now this one's neither horizontal nor vertical. So we're kind of running into an issue here where how do we go perpendicularly to this? Well, you have to think in terms of opposite reciprocal. What does that mean? That means that whatever this slope is, which it's 1 over 1, rather, the opposite reciprocal is negative 1 over 1. Opposite meaning changing the sign from positive to negative. Reciprocal meaning flipping these values. Now, 1 and 1 are the same thing, so it doesn't really show up very much. But if you tilt your head in such a way, you'll kind of see perpendicular is going to go this way. So when we count distances away from here, we have to count in this direction. Now, you can either count using your slope, meaning how long it takes for you to get up to this line, or as long as I keep things relative, I can count diagonally and make this. This is relatively 1 unit away, 1 diagonal unit away. And that's okay to do because all of them will be doing the same thing. So starting with A here, I'm going to count using opposite reciprocal slope, negative 1 over 1, with 1 diagonal unit this way. 1 diagonal unit gets me to my line of symmetry. So to find A prime, I'm going to go 1 diagonal unit away from here. This is where A prime will rest. This one's a little more difficult to do, but thankfully, I think you're going to be getting a lot of slopes of 1 or negative 1 to make this happen. B, let's do B next. B is on the other side of it, but 1 diagonal unit away. 1.5 diagonal units away. So to find out where B prime goes, let's go another 1/2 diagonal unit away. And another 1 diagonal unit away. That makes it 1.5. That's where B prime is. I know that sounds kind of weird how I say diagonal units, but hopefully you can stick with me there. And the half thing, the reason I know that is because, well, I think you can do this enough, but when you know that this slope is 1 here, I go up 1/2, I go over 1/2. So this point is literally at the point, -1/2, -1/2. So I know that's where it's intersecting. C, I think, is going to do the same thing. It's going to hit at 1/2 diagonal unit. 1, 2, 2.5. So let's do 1/2, 1.5, 2.5. There's C prime. Now notice when I did translation points, had more of a habit of, how do you say, doing some of these with math instead of with a graph. I would argue it's not probably worth it to do it in a math sense. We're doing some math with it in terms of counting. We had to find out slope and stuff like that. But most of this, yeah, we're doing it through the graph. I would say that that's more than okay to do. So I'm gonna plot, I'm gonna write down what A prime, B prime, and C prime are. And I want you to get a connection with this thing because there are actually easier ways to do this. And there, it kind of is a math sense, but I think it helps to do this first. So let's plot those. Okay, if you tilt your head 45 degrees diagonally so that this is going from up to down, you can see that mirror image and confirm with yourself that you kind of did this right, that that is reflectional across that line. So there is some sort of line symmetry there, a term we'll be using for literally for the symmetry section. Now, one thing for going across the line y equals x, and I want you to keep in mind this would only be for y equals x, kind of for y equals negative x, but keep this in mind here. This will be important if you ever take second year algebra and you start doing what are called inverse functions. Reflecting across y equals x actually means that anything that was an x value before now becomes a y value. And anything that was a y value before now becomes an x value. Sounds kind of strange. But take a look at where A was at 6, 4. When we reflected across y equals x, every x value occupied a y value. A prime is now at 4, 6. 6, 4 turned into 4, 6. B was at negative 2, 1. When it reflected across here, B became the point 1, negative 2. The x value, negative 2, became the y value here, negative 2. And 1 became 1 over here. And then C, without even looking at the graph, what was 5, 0 has now become 0, 5. Yes, it is very true that reflecting across the line y equals x does give you all of the inverse points. Everything switches. Now that's only for a line like that. If it was y equals x plus 1, you'd be looking at a whole different thing. Okay? But the other way of doing it, if you're graphing it, if you need to do it in counting and such, this was the way. Those diagonal units worked very well because these are perpendicular to your line of symmetry because they have opposite reciprocal slopes. Okay, here's rotation. I'm going to try and do it as quickly as possible here. I have my protractor. I think I have to get a compass as well. A rotation is an isometry that does not change orientation. Okay, that is not a great definition. I'm taking that one from the textbook. But what we're going to do here is rotate each image this amount of degrees. These will all be counterclockwise. Assume that if it doesn't say direction, that it's counterclockwise, about point P. Point P is drawn in all of these. What we're going to do is use a protractor. Okay, and then we are going to line up point P as if it is the vertex of an angle alongside points, in this case, D, E, and F. I'll do D first. So what I'm going to do is line this up in such a way that D is at 0 degrees from P to D. Notice that 0 right there. Okay, I'm going to go ahead and find 180 degrees. Now it's literally going all the way around, so you technically might not have to use a protractor for this one. Right, 180, I'm going to go ahead and delete, get rid of the protractor for a second. 180 degrees is just a straight line. So, I mean, shoot, why not use a ruler, right? But if you are going to use the protractor, because we're going to do it later anyway, what you would do is use your protractor, you would measure up at 180 degrees, and then you would draw a line. And what this line is going to be is a segment going out from P to the other direction after 180 degree rotation, and I need to keep that line, whatever that thing was. I need to keep that there. Okay, now you may be asking, what's so special about this segment? Well, looking back at this angle here again, this is the result of, well, it's kind of harder to see it as an angle because it's a straight angle, but here's one side of angle DP, where D prime is going to be, and here's the other side right here. Well, D prime is somewhere on this side, because here's P is your vertex, and here's 180 degrees. So we need to find out where D prime is, but we know it's on there somewhere. So how do we figure it out? Well, place your pivot here on P, And let's find out the distance here to D. It looks like I was already pretty close. Okay, there's that distance. Well, D prime is going to be the same distance away. When it doesn't change orientation here, it never changes the distance away from P. D prime and D are equidistant from P there. So D prime is going to rest right there. There it is. Okay, now this dotted line here, that's not a part of my new triangle. This is something that I could actually remove it later if I wanted to. For the sake of time, I'm going to speed up a little bit here. This 180 degrees, again, you already have your protractor. And honestly, I don't need this. It's a straight line. But I'm going to measure up where P and E are buddies with angles here. Okay, like so. And, okay, well, here's PE. So I'm going to draw another segment here coming out from P, out this way. And I know that E prime is going to be on there. Where at? Let's find this distance right here from P to E. Pretty close once again. Stretch that a little bit more. Okay. I'd say this is good enough right there. Now if I take this and switch it on the other side, E prime will be right here. Okay, on that point. Hopefully you kind of see where I'm going with this. Last one, we need to do F. If I rotate it this way, F and P lie on a line together right here. So 180 degrees this way. Let's go ahead and draw another segment. Okay, now I know F prime will exist on this segment right here. How far away? Well, let's figure out how far away P and F are. And P and F prime will be the same distance away from each other. After we do this whole rotation, doesn't matter if this was clockwise or counterclockwise, they're both the same thing when it's regarding 180 degrees, we will see how this triangle looks after a full rotation. Now I want you to keep in mind what rotations are supposed to be. It's not the same as reflection, but it's taking your points about P as if it's the center of rotation there, and moving everything about that in some direction. I don't know if any of my explanations make any sense at all. This should have looked better somehow. This probably should have been straight up and down. So let's say I screwed up some of the compass points just a little bit there. But it should be looking like that, and like that, and like that. Yeah, good enough. I can only do so much with electronic technology. So if I remove everything here that's not these segments, which you probably shouldn't do, you want to show your work when it comes to this stuff. But if I remove all, whoops, if I remove all that is not the triangles, the image and pre-image, then I will run into what I say is a good representation of pre-image, then rotate it 180 degrees around P, and you get this image here. Notice F and F prime, ooh, it should be F prime. F and F prime are here and here on opposite sides. Not that it reflected, it rotated. This swung 180 degrees over here. This swung 180 degrees over here, etc. This swung 180 degrees over here. So there's the swing of things. And we're going to do it with the other ones. I'll do it much more quickly just for the sake of time. But this time, I want you to see the angles a little bit more. So we're going to do 60 degree rotation. I have to do one at a time here. I'm going to start on P. Go to S right here. There's 0 degrees. 60 degrees is all the way right here. Okay, from here to here is going to be a 60 degree swing. Take a look at that. So S is right here. After a 60 degree swing, S prime will be somewhere over here. Okay, now as I mark that 60 degrees, I'm going to go ahead and place it where this is. So I have it in place. You'll use the protractor. There's 60 degrees. Oh, and take a look. That is exactly 60 degrees. That's actually helpful. So what I would do is I'm going to go ahead and draw one of those mini, a little segment here, going out from point P in the direction of where 60 degrees is ending up. So again, take a look at where 60 degrees went, and keep in mind that it is counterclockwise. I can now remove this guy right here. If you see this dotted red line, S prime will be somewhere on here. Where at? If S is right there, S prime is the intersection right there. So let's label that S prime, and we will move on from there. R, let's do the same thing, 60 degrees. So what I have to do here is rotate this in such a way so that P and R are now together. about like that. So the swing after this, R will swing all the way over here, 60 degrees. R prime should be somewhere around there. To figure this out for sure, I'm gonna make another segment. Going out. Let's remove the 60 degree guy right here. Compass, find out how far away R is from P. And of course, never super perfect, but we'll make do. Once again, R prime is over here. And there's my point. So it's hard to see it after, like, I mean, trust me, I won't say I've done geometry all my life, but as a teacher, okay, I'm looking at this and going, well, this looks weird, right? I don't see where the 60 is coming from. Yeah, not everything that you have, unless I was using animation with all this, not everything that you have will be exactly as you want it to appear to look. But the fact remains that every time you do this swing, what I really like about this tool is it's really showing that 60 degree angle. So now I'm going to do Q to make Q prime. You can see Q is going to swing 60 degrees and I get to Q prime here. These next parts aren't so conventional as far as perceiving what that 60 degrees really looks like. And I am sorry about that. That is the nature of the beast. But when it comes to using this stuff, the only measure we're actually doing is that 60 degrees. The rest is pretty, I don't say traditional, but you know, you're not doing too much with it. You're using a compass and a straight edge and figuring that out. If this is the distance to Q, well then Q prime is also the same distance away and it's on that one right there. And I probably should have moved this angle thing away from here first. Okay, because you wouldn't have had that there. So Q prime's right there. Now the last two things I need to do, first of all, P is one of the points on this, looks like a parallelogram. Well, P prime is going to be at the same place because P is the point that we're rotating about, so P prime will be right there. So I don't have to do anything there. That's the first thing I have to do, nothing. The second thing I have to do is go ahead and connect all these guys together. Okay, so P, Q, or P prime, S prime, R prime, try that again, R prime, and Q prime look like that after a rotation. So that's a 60 degree swing. Everything swung 60. 60 there. This one, 60 there. Everything swung 60 degrees from one point to the next. Kind of nice. Let's do this last one here. Let's get some of this stuff out of the way. I don't need 60 anymore at all. Now 90 degrees. As you can imagine, I can go 90 degrees with each point. Let's go ahead and measure that off now. And I'm going to use this and rotate about. I know it's an upside down looking 90, but if I want to do this counterclockwise, that's what I'm going to have to use. So let's do P with certain points here. Let's check out Z. Okay, there we are, just about, P with Z. Here we go, let's make a segment after that 90 degree swing out there. Let's use the compass, find out how long Z is. Okay, swing it over here. Z prime is on that right there. Should have moved that first. So there is Z prime. Okay, let's do Y next. Use our 90 degree rotation. Again, it's counterclockwise. Okay, let's extend after 90 degree swing. Let's make that segment. This time I will for sure get that 90 degrees out of the way. Move. Okay, let's measure up with the compass here. Figure out where Y prime is supposed to go based on how far away Y is from P. Okay, and it is yay far away. So Y prime, if I could rotate this, would go, well, let's just go ahead and do the arc. Whee! Boom, right there. There's Y prime. And then we'll finally do X and X prime. I just wish we could do Optimus and do Optimus prime. I'm waiting for that day. Transform, it's perfect too. Transform Optimus into Optimus Prime. Transformers. 90 degree swing, let's do it. Here's the segment. Let's get rid of this 90 degree thing once and for all. Again, you would be using the protractor for it. You could get rid of it. Now with the compass, go ahead and find out how far away X is. Let's hope it's the same distance. Oh, not the same distance away as Y. Going down, looks like that, so swinging it on over. X prime is right over here. Okay, All that's left to do is connect the points, and we're good to go. X prime to Z prime looks like, well, it doesn't let me do it perfectly, excuse me. That's all right, let's do that. Z prime to Y prime, Y prime to X prime. So there's a 90 degree rotation. And again, if you ask me, can I understand that look only a little bit, right? The main one that I can actually see here, one thing that you can notice is where 90 degrees are actually being made. Here's segment ZX, well, here's segment Z prime X prime, 90 degrees. Here's segment ZY, here's segment Z prime Y prime, 90 degrees. What's great is this one was 90 degrees. Here's segment XY, here's segment X prime Y prime. They don't ever actually match up, but if they did, 90 degrees. So again, you can see where that 90 degree rotation is coming from, and it's all clockwise. You could turn your paper, do some things like that. That's always useful. But in the end, as long as you kind of know what you're, as long as you can kind of follow your own work, I think you have to trust that your answer is right based on what you're doing. Okay, we're going to do some 90 degree rotations here. I'm going to refer to this like rotating your paper. Okay, I've made mention of that before. So what I'm going to do here on number 18 is I'm going to plot the point 5, 2. We're going to do a 90 degree rotation about the origin. When we do, we'll do it counterclockwise. Okay. What I'm going to do is take this here, and if you rotate your piece of paper 90 degrees counterclockwise, your Y axis will fall down here, your X axis will rise up here, etc. 90 degree rotation like this. Again, do it with your paper. Literally do that. Take a look at where this point ends up. What was 5, 2 has now become negative 2, 5. Well, that is a 90 degree rotation, and that's where your image is going to end up here. So, as that was 5, 2, if that was A, your image, A prime, will be at negative 2, 5. Okay. Now, there is kind of a connection with these numbers, but it's not so much the one as reflecting across Y equals X. Yes, numbers switch, and I think you're going to see something here each time, but I wouldn't go off too many patterns. I'd rather understand what I'm doing rather than try and memorize something else. Okay, the point 0, 3 after a 90 degree rotation, I don't know if I want to rotate my paper this time. I think you can see what happens. It rotates 90 degrees, stays equidistant from the origin here, it ends up right there, negative 3, 0. And you know, you do this enough times, you actually know where it's going to go. I equate things as to being close to some axis. So in other words, this one at negative 4, 1, right here, I know this is very close to the negative x-axis. And I know after a 90 degree rotation, the negative x-axis becomes the negative y-axis. So I know this guy rotates from being very close to the negative x-axis to being very close to the negative y-axis. So I already know, and I know something about the numbers being kind of the same. So I'm going to tell you right now, I know the point is going to be at negative 1, negative 4. That's not showing off. That's saying maybe you can learn something with this. Absolutely wouldn't be showing off. So let's take a look. What happens after you rotate your paper? 90 degrees. Where did it go? Ta-da! Negative 1, negative 4. So it did go there. Okay. Let's go and plot that point now. Negative 1, negative 4, and that becomes the image of that guy there. For the sake of time, let's move along. Next point, 7, 0. Again, much like that 0, 3. 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Once this rotates 90 degrees, the positive x-axis becomes the positive y-axis. So where do you think this will go? It's got to be equidistant from the origin, as the other point was. So it's got to be over here at 0, 7. I'm not going to say much more on that one. The last one here is at negative 2, negative 8, number 22. Let's go over 2 to the left and down 8. I'll do it with paper rotation as well as the other one I was talking about before. If I'm down here near the negative y-axis, as this rotates 90 degrees, the negative y-axis becomes the positive x-axis. So as my point was really close to the negative y-axis, after rotation, it'll become close to the positive x-axis. And the numbers 8 and 2 will be here somewhere. Where do you think? I'm thinking 8 this way, 2 down that way. I'm thinking it's going to be at 8, negative 2. Let's go ahead and do this rotation with the paper and see how it looks. 90 degrees. There you go. 8, negative 2. That's where it lies. So again, something after a lot of practice, you start to really get used to. This is only as simple as it is when it's going about the origin. When it's not going about the origin, that's where you really do probably have to do those things that I was talking about. Refer to what something's close to, rotate it in a different fashion. But there are your answers. Okay, now we're gonna start talking about symmetry. A figure has symmetry if there's an isometry that maps the figure onto itself. In other words, going back, notice how we did some symmetry, this one right here before. Pretend like this was one object, this red right here. And if I asked you, does this object have line symmetry? You would say it does, because if I reflect it across a line such as this one, I get the same image out. I get something mapping onto itself. That's line symmetry. So looking at that, a figure has reflection or line symmetry if half of the figure is a mirror image of its other half. So that's what we just talked about. Next one's rotational symmetry. So taking a look at what we were talking about, rotating some things here. This one works out pretty well. If I rotate this guy 180 degrees completely, using the red as well, if I consider this all one image and rotate it at 180 degrees, what ends up appearing is D prime goes where D was, E prime goes where E was, and F prime goes where F was. So you end up with the same exact image as you had before, which is kind of cool. So that is rotational symmetry. So I'm giving you examples of things that we rotated and reflected to tell you how rotational and reflectional symmetry work. So this is the opposite. Now you have the full image. Can you divide this somewhere down a line and then get something back out? So let's go and answer that question here. This butterfly, let's go ahead and draw a line right down the middle. Okay. This looks like it appears to have reflectional symmetry down the middle of the butterfly. Because if I flip this image, take a look at this, I'm going to flip left to right, boom, I end up getting, maybe it's not very perfect, but I end up getting the same image. You know what I mean? This is the same thing here as it was here, right? Same butterfly. We have to assume that that's true. Looks like it's it looks like it's a little bit crooked. Okay, so it has line symmetry that way. Now, it does not have line symmetry, just because you draw a line. I'm sorry to say this, but I've seen this a lot before. Just because you draw a line doesn't mean it has line symmetry. Some people are like, hey, take a look at that. Line symmetry, The question is, if I flip this one up and down, is that the same thing? No, that is not the same thing. So I can't reflect across that line and get the same thing out. It only has line symmetry right down the middle. Now, rotational symmetry. Rotational symmetry, a figure that has rotational symmetry is its own image for some rotation of 180 degrees or less. Now the reason why it's not more than 180 degrees is once I've surpassed 180, there's no chance that I can get the same image back anyway. So here's 180 degrees, obviously not the same thing. Nowhere on this point when I rotate it do I get the same image out by rotating it. So this does not have rotational symmetry. It has the line down the middle. That's all I'm going to say about it. No rotational symmetry whatsoever. This one, however, you might think it has line symmetry, but this one's a little different from the butterfly. Even though the butterfly had, maybe just a little bit of a hiccup here, when I check this one and try and go down some line, okay, notice how when I reflect this thing left and right, everything that was on one side went on the other. Now, I know that's the case, but when you're looking at it as a mirror image, that's not what we want. These do not have line symmetry. Things completely changed, and you can check anywhere on this. I think it's a tire rim. You can check anywhere on here, and you are not going to find line symmetry. This does not have any. Rotational symmetry, however, this does have. Take a look at this. Let's take it, and let's start spinning it. Basically, take a look at the orientation here, where this stuff is kind of up on top here. And when I rotate this after some time, you get that same look. Now, there's a change in lighting here, but that's just the way that the picture was. I'm not going to I'm not going to take anything off for that. Rotational symmetry. Boom, 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 boom. Every time I rotate, I'm getting that same pattern each time with the difference of the lighting. Okay, so it has rotational symmetry, and the question is, what is the angle of rotation? Well, here's how you figure that out. figure out how many times I rotate this before I get back to the top. See how the screen's at the top? Once, twice, three times, four times, five times. Well, you know, five times. So it took five times to do that. If you take a look at this right here, it kind of has a central angle shown five times here. Okay, this is where you're getting that symmetry. We have to find out how much this rotation was. Okay, now a full rotation is 360 degrees. So taking 1/5 of that, we'll find out the angle of rotation at any of these. Okay, so it's 360 divided by 5, or it is 72 degrees. So it has rotational symmetry at 72 degrees. Now it doesn't matter which direction I go. I could have also gone counterclockwise, and I would have appeared at the same thing as I would have before. So there's rotational symmetry at 72 degrees. A figure that has point symmetry is 180 degrees rotational symmetry. Does this have 180 degrees rotational symmetry? Well, 180 would mean if I flip this over, 180 like that, I'm back where I was before. This doesn't seem to be the case. In fact, if 72 was a multiple of 180, it would have point symmetry. 72, however, is not a multiple of 180. Here's 72, here's 144, here's 216. You already saw that I surpassed 180 degrees. No point symmetry, just rotational at 72. The last bit of problems here is involving dilation. A dilation is a similarity transformation. So while all these other ones produce isometries, rotation, translation, and reflection, while they produce isometries, meaning triangle DEF, DEF is congruent to triangle D prime, E prime, F prime, even after the rotation, or these triangles after the reflection are still the same, or after the translation of triangles and stuff, they're still the same image, they're congruent. Similarity does not have congruent segments. It has congruent angles. The segments are proportional. So what's gonna happen, it's not gonna matter so much for these ones right here because these are points. But the idea is we're gonna grow from some center. There's gonna be center of dilation. We're gonna grow away from that a certain amount. It's gonna be a scalar multiple by some scalar factor here, 4, 0.5, and 10. When it grows, like 4 and 10, it's called an enlargement. When it shrinks, it's called a reduction. Okay, so I'm gonna have point A here, 0.03. We're going to do a dilation from the origin. All of these are from the origin, so I'm going to plot that point. Okay, A is right there at 0.3. Let's go ahead and enlarge it so that it goes 4 times farther away from the center than it was before. So if this here is 3 away, if you actually counted that, you would then multiply that number by 4. And you'd say, okay, well now it's 3 times 4 away. Now it's way up here, it's 12 away. This goes up to 10, I'd say that's about 11 and 12. Here's A prime. A couple things to note here. First of all, here's the center. A and A prime are both the same direction away from the center. They're both on the y-axis. This will always be true. Not that they'll always be on the y-axis. It's always true that the slope, even though the slope is undefined, the slope to your pre-image will be the same slope to your image from your center. Now, your center is probably going to be at the origin, and these problems, they will be. Your center might not be at the origin. All you have to do is just make a dotted line here, or just make any line, but just make a line here to indicate that, okay, they're both going the same direction, the same path away. If I draw that, I should even be able to find my center if I try hard enough. That's one thing. Second thing is, I was able to count my distance because it was vertical. Well, you're not always going to be able to do that. Check out this one already. It's not going to be vertical. So what you could do as well is I could look at A and say that that point there is 0.3. And what I'm doing with both those points is the x value I'm going to multiply by 4, but 0 times 4 is 0. 3 I'm going to multiply by 4, and I get 12. So this point is 4 times more in the x direction and the y direction. Once again, the x direction here, 0 times 4 is 0, so that doesn't help very much. But you'll see it in these other problems here. Like B, the point negative 2, 6, right here, I'm going to find B prime by using a scalar factor of 0.5, dilating from the origin. Now, 0.5 means that you're reducing this. This is also 1/2. You are making every point half as much as it was before. Now, a couple things I just talked about in that last example. First of all, if I draw a straight line from my center to my pre-image, I already know that my image will be somewhere on this. It'll keep the same slope because it'll shrink. In this case, it'll shrink. It'll shrink towards the center, and it'll be half the distance away. So how can I calculate that? Well, this time, it's probably not wise to find the literal distance, meaning use Pythagorean theorem to figure it out. But what is probably wise to do is find out how far away in the x direction my pre-image is from my center, two away to the left, and it's 6 up from the center as well. So this is -2 and 6, just like this point is right here, and here's your little hint. I don't have to use these right here. I could just use the coordinate points because my center is at the origin. I just have to multiply these both by 1/2. I have to divide them by 2. -2 divided by 2 is -1. 6 divided by 2 is 3. I am at the point, -1, 3. Okay. This next one, I almost don't feel like graphing. Two reasons. One, this only goes 10 away each time, and it looks like I'm going to have to multiply something by 10. And two, I want you to know how to do it just with math. Well, if this center is at the origin, the distance away from my center is also the coordinate point that the pre-image is on. So this coordinate point is at 1.5, -2. The distance away from the origin that the image will be, C prime, will be 1.5 times 10, -2 times 10. Nothing more to it than that, really, when your center's at the origin. If it's not, I would look at counting away distances from the center. Not from the origin, but from the center. And I would multiply those by your scale factor. So that is at 15, -20. Again, probably not very easy to plot, but it looks like it'd be somewhere way down there. I'm sorry, 15, negative 20. Way down there, near my clock. So I can't really graph it. I could change the scale, but this is really what you need. Find the image. I want to know where that is. There's C prime. Okay, very last ones right here. Find the image of each set of points for a dilation with the center at the origin and the scale factor given. This time you have this is a quadrilateral. This one's a quadrilateral. I'm going to do this one once again without the graph for the sake of my sanity and saying that this is where it is. I'm going to start without the graph and then we'll plot the points. So just to show you how simple this is, once again, center's at the origin. So the distances these points are away from the center are also the coordinate points. I'm sorry, the coordinate points here are also the distances away from the center. So M prime is going to be 5 times more, scale factor 5, 5 times more in the x direction and in the y direction. -3 times 5 is -15. 4 times 5 is 20. For A prime, -6 times 5 is -30. You can see why I don't want to graph this. I you know what, I'm not going to graph it. Let's save my sanity here. 5 times 1 is 5. T prime is still at 0, 0. Imagine that my surprise, want to see that. H is at 15, 10. H prime. So if I plotted these points, what's really interesting, though, is this one. T and T prime, they're at 0, 0. Why is that? Well, besides the fact you multiply it by 5, this point is also the center of dilation. Right, if I what I am going to plot is the original points. T was at 0, 0. Okay. M was at -3, 4. A was at -6, 1. And H was at 3, 2. So this enlarged 5. All the lengths got 5 times larger than they were before. Okay. So before, these were as they are. Now they grew, its center of dilation was at T. Now what's important about center of dilation, one more thing here to note, is that as everything else grows some distance away from the center of dilation, okay, and from, the same direction away as your original points, like for instance, A prime is somewhere way out there, M prime is somewhere way out there, literally in this direction. That slope that I'm doing is like this. Notice how T can't grow anymore. If T is at the center of dilation, how can it grow away from it? 5 times away is still at it. The center can't move. So that's one important part about center of dilation that you want to know. It can't move, right? It's got to stay where it's at. So that's another interesting part about center of dilation. This last one I will graph for you, okay? It's going to be F is at negative 4, 0. And actually, you know what, for this one, because I'm going to scale every one of these. So this every increment's going to be 1 half. So 1 half, 1, 1 and a half, 2, 2 and a half, 3, 3 and a half, 4, etc. Because I'm going to do scale factor 1 half, meaning I'm going to divide them by 2, and I have enough space to do it. So this one's actually a great one to graph. So F at negative 4, 0. 1, 2, 3, 4. There's F. Yay, so much fun. U is at 5, 0. 1, 2, 3, 4. 4, 5. It still fits. And N is at negative 2, negative 5. 1, 2. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Hopefully you're understanding what I'm doing there. And look, it says fun. It's triangle fun. So here we go. Let's plot the points. This is the pre-image. Okay, the image is going to be a reduction. We're going to reduce everything to half of what it was before. Okay. Now remember, the center of dilation is here, meaning whatever point this is on triangle FUN will not move after it is reduced. If I called this point A, A prime would be exactly there as well. It's at the origin. So I'm going to shrink everything here, and it's, you know, once again, you can divide things by 2. I think that's going to be the way I'll go about this one. F prime, divide everything by 2. Negative 4 divided by 2 is negative 2. 0 divided by 2 is 0. So F prime is at negative 2, 0. 1, 2, boom. There's F prime. Notice how it's shrinking in the direction of the center. U prime, as you can imagine, will also be on the x-axis. 5 divided by 2 is 5 halves. That's 2.5. And 0 divided by 2 is 0. So this is 2.50. 1, 2, 2.5. See, this time I got to make use of this graph. There's U prime. N prime, negative 2 divided by 2 is negative 1. Negative 5 divided by 2 is negative 2.5. So this will be negative 1, negative 1, negative 2, negative 2.5. There is N. And there is the drawing, and my final drawing, for determining where the image is after I reduced everything 1 half with the center at the origin. And that's the most important part here. Because this part, as you can kind of tell, if that was A, it's still A prime. It doesn't move. Notice how everything is shrinking in that direction. Let me check one more time here with N and N prime that they are the same slope. The very last thing that you can confirm it. These should be going right through the center. And it looks like they are. N, N prime, center at the origin. F, F prime, center going through the origin. U, U prime, center going through the origin. That's where they're all meeting because they would all shrink in toward that way. Now, one very last thing I want to say, although this length is exactly half of this length, the area of this is not exactly half the area of this right here. Ratio of areas is different from ratio of perimeter or length or whatever you want to call it. So make sure when I'm saying I'm reducing this to half of what it was before, the area is not half of what it was before. In fact, the area is a quarter of what it was before, just so you know. Very interesting stuff. Okay, that's it. Fiend!